Are there any questions? Leader of the Opposition.
My question is to the Premier. A Mica ambulance team had to be sent inside Maroondah Hospital to save the life of a woman having a heart attack because the emergency department was full. Why couldn't this sick Victorian get treated in a hospital even when she was having a heart attack?
Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank at the outset our hard-working paramedics and healthcare workers who work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to take care of all Victorians. And the Leader of the Opposition is referring to an incident that occurred at Maroondah Hospital and has been reported on in the media overnight and into this morning. And both the Health Minister and I have addressed this very clearly publicly, and I'm happy to provide this information again to the House for the benefit of the Leader of the Opposition. The Minister and I have been very clear about our expectations around how Ambulance Victoria and our hospitals work together, and indeed there are very clear protocols, yes. Speaker, around how patients are transferred at that critical juncture between their ambulance care and into the hospital system. What has been reported as occurring at Maroondah Hospital has clearly not followed those well-established protocols, which is not an acceptable situation to the Minister, myself or the Government. And we need to ensure that this is not an incident that is repeated, which is why the Minister has directed Eastern Health and Ambulance Victoria to undertake a full investigation to review this as a matter of urgency.
Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
In light of the Premier's reference just then to a full investigation, will the Premier now reconsider her refusal to appear before the ambulance inquiry in the other place?
Order! 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 Order!
Premier.
Speaker, the answer is no. What I will be doing is continuing. What I will be doing is continuing the work that we have done in the past number of years, where we have doubled the number of paramedics in the Victorian community. We have added an additional $2 billion in funding, and we support our hard-working paramedics as opposed to those officers who went to war with our hard-working paramedics.
Manager of Opposition Business, on a point of order.
Speaker, I'd ask you to bring the Premier back to the question rather than debating the question, which she started to do.
Order. The Premier has answered the question. On a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Police.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I'm very pleased to say that the Victorian Labor Government will be announcing some further crackdowns on organised crime and bikie gangs with some of the toughest laws in Australia. Toughest laws in Australia, unlawful association schemes, serious crime prevention orders, and of course the banning and confiscation of outlaw motorcycle gang colours in our state. These are some of the serious matters that we're bringing before this Parliament, some of the new announcements of policy decisions that our government is making. We've already beefed up the confiscation of assets and unexplained wealth in this state. We've made those changes to the law. We're also outlining, of course, Speaker, the prescribed organisations and their members will be banned from building sites and other government work sites and free from the influence of those criminal gangs and organised crime. Can I say also that those serious crime prevention orders will allow the Chief Commissioner to make sure that those who are involved in serious criminal behaviour will be able to be prohibited from leaving the state. They won't be able to have firearms. They won't be able to have certain amounts of cash. These are the significant changes that we're making to the law that are in response to claims and requests from Victoria Police to continue to keep the finger on crime, but particularly around organised crime to disrupt and dismantle them in this state. Our $4.5 billion investment in Victoria Police, the largest police service in the country, Speaker, is making sure that they have, through Operation Viper, Task Force Luna, to disrupt and dismantle crime, make hundreds of arrests and lay thousands of charges. Can I say in particular, for organised crime, in relation to wearing gang colours and outlaw motorcycle gangs, we know they do that that to recruit members. They do that to intimidate Victorians. We will ban the wearing of those colours here in Victoria, and we'll be able to confiscate those colours when they're worn by outlaw motorcycle gangs. The test for those opposite who didn't back Victoria Police and tougher bail laws is when they put the bite on crime. Order. Or you want to have a bite with Order. The mobsters and the lobsters.
Minister,
that's your form.
Minister, resume his seat. Member for Berwick. Manager of Opposition Business has a point of order.
Speaker, ministerial statements aren't an opportunity for cabinet leakers to attack the opposition.
There's no point of order. The minister has minister to continue.
Thank you, Speaker. Only the Allan Labor government be trusted to keep the community safe.
Leader of the Opposition on a question.
My question is to the Premier. Electromagnetic interference from the Metro Tunnel is forcing Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre to transfer their inpatients to other hospitals for MRIs. Why should these cancer patients suffer pain and disruption to their treatment because of Labor's failure to manage the Metro Tunnel project?
Minister for Transport Infrastructure is warned. Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his question because it gives me an opportunity at the outset to make it absolutely clear that as we get on and deliver the transformational Metro Tunnel project, which will deliver heavy rail services into the Parkville precinct for the very first time, providing better connectivity for patients and for staff, there has not been any impact to patient care during the period of the construction and now the testing phase, which we are in.
What's your problem?
Order. Premier will resume her seat, please. Order. Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
On relevance, this was a very specific question and the Premier's had an opportunity to provide some background, but I would ask you to bring her back to the specific question.
Order. 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 Order! Order. I'd ask the Manager of Opposition Business to be succinct in his points of order. The Leader of the House on the point of order.
Speaker, on the point of order, there is no point of order. The Premier was being relevant and responsive to the question. The fact that the Manager of Opposition Business is too busy thinking about his next stunt and point of order is...
Thank you. Order. 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 Member for Brighton. Premier was being relevant in that she was referring to patients at the hospital and she was also referring to interference from the Metro Tunnel. Premier to continue.
And Speaker, we are at the stage of this exciting and transformational project where we are having test trains running tens of thousands of kilometres through the brand new 9-kilometre twin tunnels. And we're at this stage of the project, Speaker, because our government
Member
has been
Eildon
determined to deliver the Metro
Order.
Tunnel
Order.
Project.
Leader of the Opposition on a point of order.
On relevance, Speaker, the issue we're trying to address is that cancer patients at the Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre have to be transferred to another hospital for their MRIs and then brought back
Order.
To the Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre. Can
Order.
I ask you draw Order. The Premier back so
the
she Premier, can address that fundamental issue?
The question referred to why cancer patients are having their disruption to their treatment. I believe the Premier was being relevant to the question.
Of course, when you deliver transformational projects, they are of the size and the complexity of the Metro Tunnel. We have to work very closely with those institutions that will benefit from the delivery of the Metro Tunnel. And we have been, and I want to thank the hospitals, the universities, the research institutes that sit within the Parkville precinct for the way they've worked with the project deliverers of the Metro Tunnel, because it will deliver improved service services for the precinct. And as part of that, we are at the tunnel testing phase, the train testing phase, and we have currently had something like 15,000 kilometres of train testing that has been undertaken.
On a point, Premier will resume her seat. On a point of order, Manager of Opposition Business. Order. Minister for Transport Infrastructure. This is your second warning.
Speaker, on relevance, this question went to disruptions to cancer patients. The Premier hasn't addressed that fundamental part of the question, and I would ask you to bring her to the question rather than discussing the matter generally.
The Premier was going to address the answering the question in terms of the question as it referred to the Metro Tunnel project. I believe she was going to be answering the question.
Of the Metro Tunnel and how we were working in with the services delivered in the Parkville precinct, I was making the point that as part of the test train testing process that we do need to consider as part of that how we can continue to support the hospital service that are delivered. And I repeat, as I said at the outset of my answer, Speaker, that there has been no impact to patient care. Indeed, what we have done is we have put additional supports into particularly the Royal Melbourne and the Royal Women's Hospital so that they can be treated in those institutions. Now, Speaker, of course, when you're delivering transformational projects like this, you have to work in a methodical way to deliver the projects, and we're doing it in a way to not compromise patient care. Those opposite abandoned this program with neither an interest in patient care or train services for our state. We're determined to deliver this project. It will transform the way people move in and out of the Parkville precinct, patients, healthcare workers, cleaners, students, workers, and that is why we are absolutely determined to deliver the Metro Tunnel and work with our project partners to see this project realised, which those totally abandoned.
Order. Member for Croydon is warned. And a supplementary question, Leader of the Opposition.
The Premier is willing to spend at least an additional $888 million on undisclosed project disputes on the Metro Tunnel. Will this additional funding ensure that cancer patients can receive MRI scans at Peter Mac?
Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. As I repeat at the outset, we are focused on supporting patient care while we get on and deliver the Metro Tunnel project. We're continuing to work with our construction partners on both the delivery of the project.
Premier, resume her seat. Order. Order. On a point of order. On a point of order, Manager of Opposition Business.
On relevance, the Premier is being evasive. In two questions, the Premier has evaded answering the question. And I would ask you to bring the Premier back to the question.
Order. Resume your seat, Leader of the House. A point of order is not an opportunity to have a view on the answer to the question. It is to raise a point of order on relevance or debating the question and the answer. Now, I think the Premier has only just commenced her answer. I will say that she is being relevant for the moment. The Premier to continue.
Saying we'll continue to work with our construction partners to deliver this transformational project, a project that will transform the way people travel around our city and state, and also too, a project that will be delivered a full year ahead of schedule.
Yeah. On a minister's statement. The Treasurer.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And yesterday, the federal government made the ludicrous decision to cap international student numbers from January of next year. Naive, short-sighted and fundamentally destructive may be the most fitting words to describe yesterday's announcement. And I won't sugarcoat it, Speaker. These caps will have a significant impact on the Victorian economy. And I echo the words of Duncan Maskell, the Vice-Chancellor of the University of Melbourne, who said the cap on international students will have a detrimental consequence for our
Order.
University,
Order.
The higher education
Order.
Sector generally, and the nation for years to come. Some things are just common sense, and not capping the state's biggest export is one of them. In Victoria, international students generate about $14.8 billion in export revenue in 2023 and support around 63,000 jobs. These changes put at risk almost $5 billion of revenue and some 12,000 jobs. Since 2020, the state has invested almost $150 million into our international education sector. We hold 30% of the nation's market share when it comes to international students.
Order, leader of the
enrollments
opposition.
Across public and private universities, TAFEs and private colleges. Just this year, Melbourne was again named Australia's best student city and the fifth best student city in the world. The Commonwealth's cap threatens all of this. A cap on international students is a cap on economic growth, a cap on jobs, and a cap on business investment. In particular, the inner city, where traders rely on international students to provide a key workforce and consumer base. This message the cap sends to international students is that there is a limit to their welcome here. This needs to be changed.
Leader of the Opposition on
My question is to the Premier. Will the Premier guarantee that the final cost of Suburban Rail Loop East will be no more than $34.5 billion?
Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. Our government is committed to delivering the Suburban Rail Loop project, particularly the Suburban Rail Loop East section of the project, a project the Victorian community have voted twice for, and we are working to delivering that project within that $34.5 billion envelope.
Yeah. On a supplementary question, Leader of the Opposition.
General has found that Suburban Rail Loop East will, quote, be more than 11 to 20% of its current over its current approved budget. A 20% blowout means a total cost of over $40 billion. Is the Auditor General wrong?
Premier.
Well, we just want to make sure you're not verballing.
Order, 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 order.
Premier.
Speaker, I reiterate my answer to the earlier question. We are committed to delivering the Suburban Rail Loop project in the terms that we committed to the Victorian community.
Order. Premier will resume her seat.
Order. Order.
On a point of order, Leader of the Opposition.
Relevant Speaker, we just want a straight answer from the Premier.
Hear, hear.
Is the Auditor General wrong?
Premier was... Order. There's no point of order. Premier to continue. Premier to continue.
Well, Speaker, there isn't a project that we've delivered that those opposite have not been opposed to. Whether it's the level crossings.
Member for Bulleen, you can leave the chamber for half an hour.
Order.
Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
Speaker, the Premier is debating the question and evading again.
I'd ask the Premier to come back to the question.
Speaker, I've answered the question in the context of the budget and in terms of delivering the Suburban Rail Loop project, whether it's Level Crossings, Metro Tunnel, North East Link, the Westgate Tunnel, Suburban Roads, they have what they have in common. The Leader of the Opposition asks me what they have in common, Speaker.
The Leader Premier will resume her seat. Premier will resume her seat. Premier will resume her seat. Order, order. Order.
Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
Premier's defying your ruling.
I ask the Premier to come back to the question.
Speaker, and folk, in terms of how we get on and deliver infrastructure projects, the common element of all these projects is the Leader of the Opposition and the Liberals oppose them every step of the way.
Yeah. Manager of Opposition Business, on a point of order.
The Premier is unpleasantly debating the question.
Order. 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 There's no point of order. Premier has concluded her answer on a minister's statement. Minister for Education.
Speaker, I rise to update the House on how the Allan Labor government is delivering real cost of living support for parents in the education state. I had the great pleasure of being out with the member for Foot.
Order. Order. Minister will be heard in silence.
Thank you,
member
Speaker.
Member for Brighton.
At a Footscray primary school with the hard-working member for Footscray, a school that's been for 160 years delivering quality education under our government, a $20 million funding program to transform that school at 200 places, out doing the tutor learning initiative, the mental health in schools program, doing everything we can to support every student. And today, Speaker, we announced as part of the school saving bonus, we are adding textbooks. Because we know cost of living is a real pressure on everyday families, Speaker. So that's why we're getting out and making sure that every student, every family knows in the education state that we support them. Because we know education is the single most important investment we have. It's the single most important investment we have to combat disadvantage. The single most important investment we have in our nation's productivity and prosperity. That's why, Speaker, Victoria has the best NAPLAN results, the best attendance results, the best teacher workforce, the best student-teacher ratios. It's why, as a state, 50% of schools, 50% of schools built across this nation have been built right here. It's why we support our teacher workforce. We don't kick teachers out of the party room. We support them. We support teachers. That's why we make sure that teachers are front and centre of the education state. I wouldn't go there if I was you. Because we know Moira Deeming is going to do you slowly.
Through the chair. Order. 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 Leader of the Opposition will come to order. And I would ask members at the table to cease their verbal abuse across the table. Member for Malvern, on a point of order.
Yes, the Kmart Keating should direct his remarks through the chair.
Order. Okay. Order. 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 Member for Berwick is warned. Minister. The Minister, through the chair. Through
Speaker,
the chair.
On the point of order.
On
Speaker,
the point of order.
The member for Malvern, the out-of-work barrister.
Order.
Hansard, 1933.
I think someone needs a barrister.
Order.
1933.
What is your point of
Speaker
order?
Speaker Blackburn.
What
general
is your
principle,
point of order?
It is not a point of order. You cannot inject to prevent a member from making their speech.
I'd
the
ask.
Premier can't make a speech in here without the oaths opposite. I can't make a speech without those opposite. Constantly interjecting
order.
Right through question
order.
Time.
Order. There is no point of order. I'd ask the Minister to direct his comments through the chair. The Minister to continue. Has the Minister concluded his ministerial statement? On a question. On a question, the member for Richmond.
Thank you, Speaker. My question's for the Premier. In 2 weeks, the world's largest weapons manufacturers will gather in Melbourne for the Land Forces Expo to showcase their products to trade delegates from around the world, including those that fuel Israel's genocide in Palestine and violent oppression across the world. The principal sponsor of Land Forces is the Victorian Labor Government. In response to community opposition, Labor is mobilising 1,800 police, the Mounted Branch and the Riot Squad will be there to ensure that this weapons convention can continue to operate in heightened local and global circumstances. Land Forces creates an unacceptable risk to the safety, peace and social cohesion here in Victoria. Will the Premier be a leader for peace, step in now and cancel the Land Forces Expo?
I didn't hear the last part of the question from the member for Richmond. The member for Richmond will be heard in silence. Just the last part of your question, member for Richmond.
Thank you, Speaker. Land Forces creates an unacceptable risk to safety, peace and social cohesion here in Victoria. Will the Premier be a leader for peace, step in now and cancel the Land Forces Expo?
Member for Narre Warren North is warned. Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. And I thank the member for Richmond for the opportunity to provide clarity and completely reject her characterisation of the Land Forces Conference that is being hosted here in Victoria in conjunction with the Australian Army between the 11th and 13th of September. This is an international event that is where we will be hosting visitors from around the world who will be engaging in a number of meetings alongside a trade and investment presentation from those involved in the defence industry. Yes, it is a defence industry conference, and it is an industry that is a legitimate industry and an industry that supports tens of thousands of jobs in our community. In the work that they do, we do support as a government, we do support the defence industry in terms of the work they do in employing tens of thousands of hard-working Victorians. In terms of the reference that the Greens member has made regarding risks to safety and peace, the only risk that is presented to social cohesion in this state comes from those who want to use conflict overseas
and bring it here
to drive conflict on the streets of Melbourne. Speaker, anyone who does this should and must be condemned. They should not have used the privilege of this place to stoke further fear and division.
That's right.
What we should be doing, Speaker, as a united Parliament, is supporting those, whether they be from Israel or Palestine, whether they be from the Ukraine or Russia, whether they come from Sudan, where there is horrific conflict in all parts of the world. We should be showing them love and support and care, not using that conflict that is happening that is devastating families here. It is devastating families here, Speaker. And I would suggest to any Member of Parliament who wants to use events like this to stoke further division, fear, violence, because I can tell you what, Speaker, having attended the State Labor Conference, where the member for Brunswick was standing with people behaving in a completely unacceptable way, we have to show leadership, Speaker. We have to show leadership on this critically important issue.
Member for Richmond on a supplementary question.
The Victorian government's responsibility should be first and foremost to this community, not to protect multinational weapons companies by bringing their war.
Member for Melbourne can leave the chamber for half an hour. I'd ask members on my right to cease interjecting and let the member for Richmond have her question. Member for Richmond.
The Victorian government's responsibility should be first and foremost to protect this community, not the multinational weapons companies, by bringing their wars and their weapons to our peaceful city. Melbourne is a peaceful city, but the Minister for Police has threatened protesters, saying that every resource we can bring to bear will come down on top of you. Under the Victorian Charter of Human Rights, police must respect and protect the right to protest. They must not use force or other measures to limit or disperse peaceful protesters. By international human rights standards, disruption, civil disobedience, and peaceful direct action are keystones of the right to protest.
Order!
And not considered violent in either practice or under the law. So, does the Premier support the right to peaceful protest?
Order. 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 Order.
Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
120. I'd ask you to consider, even if you took away and consider, the fact that it may be an opportunity for you to make a ruling on incitement. My view is that the words that the member are using are inciting and undermining social cohesion, and I think it would be clear to
order.
Say that both sides of this
order.
Chamber have that view, and I would ask
order.
You to consider
order.
Making a ruling.
Order. Order. I take on board what the Manager of Opposition Business has raised. It's not a point of order. However, I do ask the member for Richmond to address her questions to the chamber according to the standing orders in relation to being relevant, succinct, and factual. Now, the Premier will respond.
Thank you, Speaker. In answer to the member for Richmond's question about do I support peaceful protests, of course I do. My question to the member for Richmond, does the member for Brunswick support peaceful protests? Or does he support protests that resulted in violence? In violence. Does the member for Richmond support peaceful protests? Or does she support protests that bring more violence to the streets of our city? Does the member for Paran support peaceful protests? Or does he support his colleagues? Does the member for Melbourne, and I say
member
this,
for
Speaker,
Sunbury.
I say this, Speaker, because we will not be lectured by the Greens political party about peaceful
order, member
protests.
For Richmond. Member for Richmond.
And I will not, Speaker, stand by and allow this sort of behaviour come to the floor of this Parliament. This is the place for leadership, and on no more important an issue than social cohesion, ensure that violence overseas does not
order.
Bring violence to our streets.
On a minister's statement, I call the Minister for Planning.
Thank you, Speaker. We know there's nothing more important than finding a home, a safe, secure and affordable home. Yet for many, many Victorians, finding a home is becoming harder and harder, and it shouldn't be. And the Allan Labor government is doing something about this. If we're going to get more affordable homes, we need to build more of them, and we need them close to jobs, transport and services. Mm-hmm. Speaker, we need to share the places we love. But not everyone shares that view. Some start backing up the utes, tuning up the megaphones every time they hear of a housing project in their backyard. Their instinct is to block, not build, locking out younger generations from getting a home they deserve, stopping older generations from being able to stay close to the neighbourhoods they know and love. Their very own shadow housing spokesperson has called out this behaviour, labelling it immoral.
Order.
And, Speaker,
order.
It is immoral
order.
And it's
the
unfair.
The Minister will resume her seat. Order.
Member for Brighton. You have a point of order? Well, then I would ask you not to interject until you are called on the point of order. On the point of order, Manager of Opposition Business.
Inappropriate for the Minister to use a ministerial statement to attack the opposition.
I'd ask the Minister to come back to her ministerial statement without reflecting on those opposite. Member for Frankston, Leader of the Opposition, Minister will be heard in silence.
Thank you, Speaker. And it's nasty. How nasty can you get when those opposite look to blame our newest Victorians
Minister,
and our oldest
Minister
Victorians?
Minister will resume her seat. Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
Speaker, the Minister's defying your ruling, and I presume reading
order.
The speech.
Order. Order. I'd ask the Minister to come back to her ministerial statement and not attack the opposition. Is the Minister reading from notes?
Minister, to continue.
Thank you. So, Speaker, we won't scapegoat. We won't blame our newest Victorians or our oldest Victorians for the housing crisis. We say yes to more homes. We said yes to more homes in Frankston. 100% affordable homes, close to public transport, close to services, close to jobs. We said yes to over 300 homes in Sydney Road, Coburg. 195 of them affordable. Potential homes for nurses, for teachers, for retail workers in a really fabulous location. And just this week, Speaker, despite the objections from the member for Brighton, we said yes to 80 more homes in Brighton.
Order! Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
The Minister, Speaker, has now defied you twice, and I would ask you to ask the Minister to deliver something that doesn't just simply sledge the opposition.
Order. The Minister will come back to her ministerial statement without reflecting on those opposite.
Speaker, the Allan Labor government is saying yes to more homes because this government's priority is on making sure every Victorian has a home that they deserve. You can huff and you can puff. You're not blowing any more homes down.
Through the chair, Minister. On a question, Leader of the...
My question is to the Premier. Four Labor members, the Education Minister and Deputy Premier, the Employment Minister, the Member for Mordialloc and the Member for Box Hill, all secretly lobbied against Labor's decision to impose an unfair schools tax. Why has the Premier imposed a tax which her own Deputy Premier doesn't support? There we go.
Member for Mornington can leave the chamber. Anyone else who is holding a pamphlet will be leaving the chamber as well. An hour. Members know that is unparliamentary behaviour. And I'm very disappointed that you would choose to defy the rulings of the House. The opposition leader was asking a question, and I think that the Premier deserves the right to have an answer. The Premier. In silence. Member for Narre Warren North can leave the chamber for half an hour. The Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I would like to thank my hard-working colleagues, the Member for Box Hill, the hard-working Member for Box Hill, the hard-working Member for Mordialloc, the hard-working Member for Eltham and Minister for Employment. Who else did you mention? Come on, who else did you mention? The hard-working
Order.
Member for Nidri, the hard-working
Order.
Deputy Premier, the hard-working Deputy Premier.
Order!
And Speaker.
Order!
And Speaker.
Order. The Premier will be heard in silence.
And Speaker, I'd like to thank you as well as the Member for Bendigo West. These members are all hard-working Members of Parliament, Speaker.
Order. The Member for Eildon has a point of order.
I ask you to ask the Premier to be relevant to the question. She's clearly fluffing around because she doesn't want to answer it.
The Premier was addressing the question. The Premier to resume.
Fluffing alone, I think. Speaker, I was acknowledging those hard-working members of Parliament for doing their job as a local member of Parliament, Speaker. And I'm proud that they're part of our hard-working team supporting schools right across the state, Speaker.
Order. Leader of the House, Member for Frankston.
Leader of the Opposition on a point of order.
I ask that you bring the Premier back to the question that was asked.
Premier was being relevant to the question.
Hardworking members of Parliament doing their job. And I'm telling the Leader of the Opposition about hardworking members of Parliament doing their job. Now, Speaker, from time to time, ministers will get letters from members of Parliament on particular issues in their electorate. Clearly, on this instance, there were letters that were sent to the minister on this particular matter. And, Speaker, it reminds me of a time when I was busy removing level crossings as the Minister for Transport Infrastructure. Very
order.
Busy.
Order. Premier will resume her seat. Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
Premier is required to be factual. The letters weren't sent to the minister. The minister wrote one of the letters.
Order. There's no point of order. There's no point of order. Premier. Premier to continue. Order.
In the context of members of Parliament, in the context of members of Parliament representing their communities, whilst we were removing level crossings that were routinely opposed by the Liberal Party, I remember the member for Croydon asked me to remove a level crossing in his electorate.
Manager of Opposition Business, on a point of order.
On relevance, this question was specifically around imposition of a tax, and the Premier hasn't even referred to her tax yet.
I ask the Premier to come. Order. Order. Well, it did refer to letters to ministers. I do ask the Premier to come back to the question.
I would hope Victorians see that this is members of Parliament representing their communities, advocating on their behalf, just as others have done, on one hand opposing level crossings but secretly asking to remove the one in their own backyard. Yeah. And I thank my colleagues for doing their job.
Yeah.
Order. Order. The Minister for Transport Infrastructure. It's becoming very tiring for me to hear your voice today. Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
Order. Order. The member for Bulleen.
Order. Leader of the Opposition has a point of order.
I stand to be corrected, but the member for Bulleen was warned once and then removed from the chamber. The Minister for Public Transport Infrastructure has repeatedly been interjecting. You've warned him three times and yet he remains in the chamber. Can I seek some clarification?
There's no point of order. Order! Order! There's no point of order. Leader of the Opposition on a supplementary question.
In his letter to the Treasurer, the member for Box Hill said, quote, many Kingswood College parents are hardworking, two-income families who make significant financial and personal sacrifices to send their children to that school and who do not have the means to weather fee increases. Why are such hardworking, two-income families in Box Hill being punished with higher fees because of this government's schools tax?
Order. Member for Morty Alec can leave the chamber for half an hour. The Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. I was asked about the arrangements with non-government schools, and I note for the record that 92% of non-government schools have retained their payroll tax exemption, and we continue to support non-government schools in a range of different ways. I also note that the Leader of the Opposition referred to correspondence to the Treasurer. I too have correspondence to the Treasurer, asked from a Member of Parliament, asking the Treasurer to consider directing the State Revenue Office to coordinate with local councils to identify likely vacant properties in their area for compliance. This was a local Member of Parliament advocating for the extension of the vacant residential land tax in their electorate from someone who opposed this proposal. Members of Parliament write to ministers all the time, Speaker.
Premier. Manager of Opposition Business on a point of order.
Premier is debating the question, Speaker.
Premier has concluded her answer. On a minister's statement, I call the Premier.
And I'm delighted to update the House on the work our government is doing to build more homes for more Victorian families, Speaker. And, Speaker, I think when you consider why we are working so hard to build more homes, it's because we want, Speaker, we want young Victorians particularly, to have the chance to live in the community that they grew up in, close to mum and dad, close to their family and friends, close to their jobs, close to perhaps great healthcare services, public transport and green space. And last week, Speaker, I was delighted to join the Minister for Planning in such a location, Speaker.
Leader of the Opposition, in the suburb of Camberwell, where we announced
the start of our work on the 10 new activity centres across the state, Speaker. Now, when it comes to this community, Speaker, the community of Camberwell, it was a bustling community, Speaker. There's shops, there's jobs, there's trams, there's a level crossing-free Lilydale line running through the heart of Camberwell, Speaker. Let me repeat that again. Level crossing-free Lilydale line, Speaker. This is the perfect spot, Speaker, the perfect spot to unlock more homes for more young Victorians. So future John and Janes can have the opportunity to live close to where they grew up, close to those important family supports. These are exactly the sorts of communities, Speaker, that shouldn't be locked up, they should be opened up. They have the services, the jobs, the infrastructure and the space to be able to locate more homes for more communities, more homes for more Victorians.
Member for Caulfield.
We know those opposite oppose this every
Leader
step of the way.
Opposition.
And we are get on and build
Order.
More homes for more Order. Victorians.
Unbelievable disrespect across the table today. Time for questions has ended.